Let's just see how it goes. How about this one? There is nobody signed on to our Zoom class. There's not even one person signed on to our Zoom class, just so you know. Not even one person signed up. Well, I will try to invite more people so that we get more people.
Now, Rachel mentioned she couldn't come today, but she has the link saved in her calendar.
All right, what about, said Rachel. Not good at names today.
It's been a while.
But she's an officer now. Who else we got?
Maria?
Sure, where's Maria?
Oh, actually, I do know. She doesn't live in Minnesota at the moment. I think she's in Wisconsin.
Oh, well, that's clever. And then, who was the guy that was your friend?
Jean-Noël.
Jean-Noël, where's he? He might not even know. He's not on Facebook. Did you guys send him an email? Do you know? Do you have Jean-Noël's email?
If it was not in the list, then I can add it.
Well, I think whenever we invite somebody like to Zoom classes or training, we should invite anybody in the history of anybody that's opted for one day.
We definitely have a lot of people.
Send them a thing, and then because they might sign on and start training.
Are there any rules for the Zoom stuff, like how far apart we have to stay?
Well, for sure we have to stay 6 feet apart, but for yelling and stuff, we should probably stay more. So even with just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, if we had 2 rows of 3, that gives you lots of room to spread out. And when we, well, you're counting, you checking my counting? What?
Sorry.
How'd I do?
Fine.
Okay. When we line up to start class, the same deal. Don't get close to people, stay far apart. There's actually systems and styles that do that. They just spread out and all day loud and then they go. So. Let's try that part. Line up. Well, like high and low, so John, where there's some more.
Okay.
But still stay apart, everybody. Oh man, it's tough. All right, let's slide down. That's too far. Slide down a little bit. That's good enough. All right. So for the first few classes, I'm thinking that we're just going to train to try to get back in the groove. Maybe some moving, which to me kind of needs repetition, and not overly complicated stuff, just enough to kind of make it start to feel good again. I think it'll take some adjustment to get used to training with your mask on, and we will probably take breaks every few minutes just to stand around and do nothing, as is recommended by the University of Minnesota guidelines. During such breaks, you're not going to take your mask off, so don't. You can slip it out and drink water, and we'll stop at a settlement for a few 5 minutes or something like usual, and then go again. So on Mondays and Fridays we're here. On Wednesday I'd like to do a 6 o'clock Zoom class from my house, like we did before. So I bought a really fancy Zoom or webcam, so I'll be able to look right at you as you're watching, talking to you. I want to start formally, if we haven't in a long time. So, this is the first step, is we can get down and get back up. See? Not so easy. Do you know what to say?
No, I forgot.
That's all right.
Do you want me to do it? Or do you want to go through what they mean?
I totally don't care. You can make an executive decision.
Lock so. Yummy. Show me knee break. Sensei, right?
Well, I discovered during our supper that I could not use my nose because my nose depends too much. questions, suggestions, comments before we start? Then spread around a little bit. We want to pick up 1 foot, pull around your ankle and toes. Switch, away. Other foot. Further away. Feet together across the knees. Other way. Feet apart on the hips. Other way. Use your legs. Pump your arms. Grab it on. Switch. Cross. Pull your feet in, body. Feet apart, keep it up. Touching down and forward. And back. And forward. And back. And forward. And back. Keep your foot forward. Switch. Side. Switch. Around, torso. Sway, okay? And stop. All right, just rest in the sway. Switch. Switch. Stretching deeper. Follow your foot. Drop your hip. Reach up. Open the arms. Squeeze your shoulder blades together. Twist with over your right shoulder. Touch your head to the floor by your front foot. And up, you can have your leg straight. Take your left arm, reach down, up, I meant right arm. Reach down, up, reach down, up, reach, and reach. Switch to the other hand. Reach, 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 and reach. Other way. Ball your foot, drop your hip to the top. Twist, look over your left shoulder. Touch your head to the floor, by your front foot. And straighten your leg. Down to the left, reach. Reach and exhale. Reach. Reach. And reach. Use your right hand. Reach. 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 And reach. Drop down to one side. Switch. 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 Switch, 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 and switch. Rotate all the way over. Stretch the other side of your thigh. Back. Forward. Back. Forward. Back. Over, and back. Switch over to the other side. All the way over. Stretch the outside of the thigh. Back. Over. Back. Over. Back. Over and back. Put your feet in the spot. So I'm sure I've told this story before, but I think I made that exercise up. I read a bunch of stuff, I studied different stretches, I found out my problem, and it's really only half the exercise that I envisioned. If I was more flexible, I'd be reaching out for my hamstring and going back and turning over, or back over to the hamstring on the straight leg. But anyway, I was really happy. I thought this was a great exercise. Something loosening up my hip. I made it up. Great. And then one day, I was probably in yoga class doing the exact same exercise. And I thought, oh crap. I didn't make it up. I promised I was somewhere. So I said something to them. And they said, no, we saw you doing it. And it looked good. So now we do it. So now I'm back thinking I did it. Although it's totally possible many other people in the world would, because they have it. Straighten your legs and your legs and sit down. Roll up. Out of the hip. Switch. Right. Side to side. Squeeze up my knee. Switch. 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 Switch and switch. Keep your own mind. That's simple. Switch. Switch. And switch. Yeah, that is perfect. Turn to the camera. So it might be a little more difficult to trigger the mask. Can you guys hear me okay? Because I'm very loud. I used to train with this guy who was constantly trying to introduce more realistic training. And a part of what he did was he wore a kendo headgear. In this case, it had like a thick screen over it. And it mounts to your shoulders so you can hit in the head and be friends with your body, especially your head and neck. But, especially when you first put it on, you can't see. It looks like shadows of people. And so he said, "Are you ready?" And I said, "Yeah." Oh, he hit me before I finished saying yeah. And it really rocks him, even though that's what your message might be going. And his theory is that if you ever actually have to defend yourself, it might be in less than ideal conditions. It might be dark. It might be smoke covered. It might be you already got hit and you can't see much of the shadows. Breathing is kind of that way too. You might be out of breath. Maybe you took to run away. Maybe you got hit. Maybe you're just tired. But if you can train successfully in somewhat adverse conditions, it helps later. So you should feel privileged and honored that you can train with this mask on. It's going to help you in the future. Feet together. Out. Second position. Left arm, left leg forward, get it back. Hey! Hey, go back. Try it again this time. Yeah. And you do it every block. Like you have good spirit and enthusiasm. Hey! Counter punch out. Nice, straight, tall posture. Like somebody's lifting your head. Use your feet. Twist your hip down and face. One. Counter punch body. Heel. One. 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 Heel. Switch hands, switch feet. Other side. Again, nice, very tall posture. Twist your hips and down. One, two, 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 one, two. Hey, all right, rest for a minute, bring up your legs. So most of you know this part, but I'll tell you anyway. When you move in karate, you want to try to keep your spine and your torso very stable and level. You don't want it to wiggle. So if I was just in place, most of you would not. There are some people that do, but most of you don't ever hold them. But it's relatively easy to start to keep your body here and just move from your center and move your arms. You got that part? But when you twist, it kind of hides things. So some of you still have a little bit of a roll and a roll. Roll, and you don't know it as much when you try and turn. So as much as you can, keep nice and straight and tall, like this, but your body turns at the same time. But nothing from here to here moves, it's still straight. It doesn't wiggle in the middle. So just try to stay more stable. Right? Left leg forward, counter punch out. Right? Twist down your head. One, two. Three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, Here's my theory. That's pretty far away. So I'm going to try to touch you without invading your personal space every once in a while. So when you counterpunch, you're pretty straight here. And then you tap on your butt up. Gotta get underneath you more. Under this way. There you go. So that's straighter. You tell a little. It's kind of hard to tell when you. If I went up and moved them, the push them would be easier. But in some places, they don't tell you anything. They just whack them and stick. This is such a versatile tool. You. Push your head. Twist more. One. Butt out again. So a little bit, your pelvis tilts when you dab. Two. Turn more. So if you try to figure out how to keep this together, one, the part right now, because we know that's better. Can you feel that pulse against? Two, turn your hip more. Kind of a basic thing, but super important. So, of the people that are wiggling, it's this kind of thing a little bit where your hip goes out of alignment, then it comes back, and then it goes out. So that's on the bottom part. Some of you have a disconnection, and I guess it is, between your bottom half moving and your top half moving. So there's a lot of different ways that happens, but what I see once in a while is everything goes perfect, hip hand, or hip shoulder, and your whatever holding, just a little wiggly. Which sometimes feels cool, but isn't quite what you want to do right now if you want to do. Switch feet. So you're on your right leg in front, right? Yes? Step. One. Twist and pull together. Two. Three. Four. Five. Six. Seven. Eight. 9, 10, 1, 2, 3. So this isn't a bad place to punch. It's fine. 4. This is way too far over there. That's a little better. So oftentimes, especially under counterpunch, it's not really dead center of you. It's not really here, but it's on its way there. And when you get there, it went a little bit further. But this is kind of a natural, strong place, and the more you try to change it, it screws up your strength. There are some systems and styles that teach you to punch off to the side. That's not completely wrong. It kind of depends on what you're doing, but right now, you're heading towards the center. So with your jab, and with your counter punch. But they might not really be as in line as some people try to cut. Because people get, this one's pretty straight in my mind. But this one's not. This one's on its way there. And to get it there, takes a little extra weird. There, punch in the middle of that. The whole rest of it is messed up. So most of these guidelines are making you strong and stable, not just because of how it looks. Couple more, kind of a joke. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, much better, butt out, eight, nine, ten. My hip, my rest for a second, check it out. You're doing really good. Relax. Lots of them are really good. Hey, left leg forward again. Counter punch out. Right. Two punches, one count. Head starting. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. tall posture. Two punches, one pound. One. Two. Three. Four. Five. Six. Seven. Eight. Nine. Ten. Nine. Showed up with my attorney, the sound of that, just for the fourth time in like a couple weeks. So, he thought this is gonna be so cool. We're gonna do what, I don't know, some advanced class, some really cool planning, some competition I've never seen before. And there were a lot of people in class, 20, 30, 40, big room, long after 10 steps. Started at 9 a.m., and that guy counted 10 down and 10 back. And then the next guy counted 10 down and 10 back. 700. 1, 2, 3. But all the way down the line, the guy thought, oh, finally, you know, it's been half an hour of this, we're gonna do something else. He started to move. 1, 2, 3. And the guy said it was like torture at first, because he was anxious to do something else. And then he got kind of resigned, like, okay, we're gonna keep doing this. The guy hired pretty soon, we'll do something else. Pretty soon he's gone, I'm going to do anything else. And then he started to think, maybe I should pay attention to what's going on. So it took him at least 45 minutes or more before he started to pay attention to what he was doing with his body and changing it. And then comparing himself to the people on one side and the front, he could feel somebody who was better, quicker, more precise. And to this day, he thinks that's one of the best classes he ever had. And so sometimes you tell that story and you say that's the stupidest thing you've ever heard. That's irresponsible. Many people just have to find this for 2 hours. That's just ridiculous. But then the point was, these masters that you watch that do the incredible demonstrations, the jumping, the leaping, the throwing people around, that's how they train every day. They train from their basics, which is a core part of them, and to expand them into the new techniques was easy. We can skip all these basic concepts and try to go up one step, and then up one step that's kind of flashy but not a lot of effect. I thought that was fair, but I'm not going to make you 7 times for another hour and a half. Someday, if you're really good, maybe we will. But for now, eat together, bow. Step forward with your left arm, left leg down, left. Eight! Rising block. I need to get up. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now don't push your shoulder part together. Your arms up here too far. Hold it. Kind of. Now turn your whole body sideways. Yep. Backwards. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Moving forward. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Backwards. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Hey! Hey, rest in some moments. So there's some stuff that we used to think was very advanced technique. And then the way Wing Yang kind of taught it, it was like the most basic part. We have to be able to do this part, or you're not even doing the right technique. And one of those is the idea that you're moving from center and you move your feet without lumbering forward on each one. And I introduced that to all of you relatively early, and I tried to do this. And I see a lot of you are still doing a good job on that. But still remind yourself, your center is going to reach, and you reach forward. When you go backwards, reach backwards. Don't drag it, and then go. There's not a two-step to it. When you're learning or training or facing a problem, it's perfectly legit. Push with this leg, bend that knee, drive forward, push again. There's a 3 or 4 step thing to it. That's perfectly fine. But if you're moving forward and backwards pretty good, then start to remember your feet have to reach from your center when you go. And that's retained when you land. So I notice it when people walk. They used to say when people tested for the higher ranks, they can tell if they were passed just by the way they walked on the floor. And some people thought that was just a metaphor, but no. If people walk this way, heavy, they're not quite getting this idea that you're sitting in regents. So you would walk without the pom 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 pom. There's just a little bit of control left, even though you're putting your hand in your foot. Part of karate, but eventually should be part of the way you move all the time. Hey, left leg forward. Rising butt counter punch. One. Two. Three. Four. Five. Six. Seven. Backwards. One. Two. Three. Four. Five. Six. Seven. Hi, for just a second. When you do any move, and I tend to see this on turn four, you have to coordinate your hands and feet. That starts at the same time and ends at the same time. So quite often you get people, they go one, they leave their hand there, and then they just match it at the end. Or they start at the same time, and then wait until it's time that's wrong to do. This has to start, this has to start, go. Go. You have to match. It changes things. So when I watch you do your right block, some of you, there's a time you initiate, so that's legit. Right? So that's not one, that's okay. But when you add the counter punch in there, all of a sudden, you're still doing the first half without movement. There's plenty of time to make it match. It starts at the same time. So you just gotta be aware of it as you're talking about your basics. So here's a guideline, not a law, not a rule. And it gets confusing because sometimes conflicting information is part of the same whole. So I say to you, when you send a punch, in your first learning, this stays here. Stay, 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 go. You watch it when you knock this way, one, two. But when your body's gonna hit, go towards the end, right? Everybody knows that. But when you get better at it, your hand foot has to start. No! It's gonna start when you start. It makes you way faster. So that's not always true. So just be aware of, am I doing what I'm supposed to do? One thing that people do a lot of is they hold the middle. Because it looks sharp at the beginning, but doesn't matter. Well, left leg forward. Rising back counter punch. What? You. Three, four, five. Backwards, yeah, and counter punch. Two, three, Class dismissed. just leave it or I'm going to just take a break. Thank you.
It did stop. All right.
All right, we're going to call back in, and I suspect we're going to start off with Kata. And I thought we'd do a bunch of advanced Kata, but all our advanced people left, so we'll just do Kata that we can remember. So, Kau. And how many of you two take two guys and backwards? You. Can you move in a little bit? And maybe a couple steps to the side of your hand. Hey, I'm sure. Out. And down.
And jump.
All right. One, two, three. One, two, three. Just a little bit engaged to keep you stable. One. Just flip it over a little bit. Two. So sometimes, in the 40 years I've been training, you take time off because you're injured, because you're busy, because you travel, because you don't last, because you're something. And sometimes, when you come back, everything's terrible. You can't quite fix it anymore, you can't remember your pattern, nothing works right. Every once in a while, when you come back, things are better. It's like if you have a new outlook on stuff, it took some time to settle into your brain. So, if it sucks, when you come back, keep working at it. And if it's better, just be happy. You know what? This is good. And then we'll keep working on stuff. Try again. Hand shutter. Out. Like that.
Jump.
Boy. Lower. Chill.
Went a little lower.
Yep.
A little more nickel.
What?
Get sideways. Lower. It's all block. Down, 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 down.
Chill. Beat it.
Something else. So look over there. Guideline.
Oh, we're a punch. So what they generally tell you is punch for your own shoulder flexor type. Which is kind of true, but if you do it too much again, you end up kind of too weird angles. So if you had to be wrong, being just a little high is better than being a little too low. This is a bad angle for punching. That's okay, that's not bad. Eventually though, you have to distinguish between body and head, and if you're always kind of punching in the middle, doesn't do you good. But the tricky part is, can you do that for a second? Assuming my sides are bigger, and I'm in a stance, my shoulder flexors right now are only like his belly button. So a little bit higher. Is kind of, that's okay. I mean, I'm still going to hit this all the places, even though I'm higher than mine. Some of them are guidelines that you have to experiment to find the right spot, but sometimes it's a really good reason to do it one way and not another way. Hey, I need that. Out. Head up. So down by everything, we greet each other. to make sure I don't hit and hang on to it afterwards before I stop. Then the kid is up into the grinder and then the eye can be conscious of the body. So it helps if you can see it. Walk hit, kick on the tongue. It helps me if I can see it. Does that make sense? What I just said? There's only one weird part in the session. There are many weird parts in this kata, and some are more important than others. And so I did this kata for many years because I learned it first. And I always thought there were two ways to do this. I had snap and back to strike. The Japanese always left his arm out. And then go. We went 1, 2, 3. Turns out there's like 10 variations of that. They're all fine. But the path of this hand is way more important than I thought. So this was pointed out to me by a senior karateka that they do start punching my head. And I'm saying this is a block that this is. And I do it this way. This doesn't block do it. Oh, you have to go higher. Well, then I still like I miss. The path has to be up and over and then back. So that as this is coming in my head, is intercepting it, moving to the side, then coming back. And if I'm using this thing that needs a strike, it works just fine as head break there. This comes up in Heian Samurai. We do this. No. You can't go like a little bit up and then down. Just a little bit. Just enough to make sure that if there's something here, you're catching it by habit. So that path and that path are the same thing. So if you don't stick, if this is here and you go one, you cover that. Regardless of what you do after, you pull it back and you're there, that path has to cover your face. So if I stick this in your face, do you have it? I don't care what your face is. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2. Oh, look, you did it. See, that's all it is. But if you don't do that in the habit, it won't happen when you do. So this was a very basic idea that seems to be missing from most people's training, because most people just think these are movement. They don't like it. It matters how you apply. And finally, about back and strikes, the path can be straight sideways. The path can be straight over the top. The path can be kind of a 45. It totally depends on what you're doing, where it's coming from, what you're hitting. But in a kata, do one of those. And I'll do two of these and go. 1, 2, 3. Every time that you just hit it, it's up there. It's... So, good job. Thank you.
Questions?
Yes.
You said in one of the videos that the Anigam was probably the most important kata.
I think so.
Oh, wait. Not taking.
So, if you start with Anigam, it's one of the most important kata. If you start with Teki, then that's one of the most important kata. The deal is that the Teki kata, I think, are much, much older. And they were meant to be a complete self-defense system, which all of the kata, the advanced kata especially, were supposed to be. Striking, grappling, trapping, throwing, killing blows, holding blows, pressure points, all in there. And it kind of went away. But when Tosu started to teach middle school children, 12 to 14 year old children, the advanced kata like Hunky Dai and Hung Yaks, they were too complex, too long, he thought, for them to figure out in the short amount of time he had them. So maybe he had them once or twice a week for a month, and then they were able to move on and do something else. So he created the Heian Kata, the specifically the idea of the first one he taught, I think it's a self-defense system. He didn't just randomly say, hey, I'm just going to make this up and make you do it because it's kind of funky. I think he thought after 50 years of training, this is one of the most important things to know how to do. So John, he's got this punch to me in the head again, which is kind of really close. This is a common method here. That's like one of the most basic things in the whole world. And as karate people, we don't seem to know that. Boxers know to cover their head. Everybody knows that. Oh no, we do something else. So, let's bring forward our mind. The idea of one step punch, this doesn't make any sense. It's just stupid. What's this have to do? It should be here. Why am I blocking this far away? I should move a little bit to knock it out. So, but if you make the attack close, that becomes a whole new deal. This becomes very useful. And although you think this move only shows up in Handgun, turns out it shows up everywhere. So, especially if you link this to your first flinch, you can hit. There's only 3 or 5 flinch responses. One is he throws a punch in my head and he's fighting back. I don't care what he hit. One is he throws a punch in my head and I kind of do that. And this is in kata also. Maybe he's punching at my groin and going, oh my god, this kind of stuff with this technique. So there's only a couple of responses. You scare 10 people in a row, there'll be 1, 2, or 3, or 4 things that look a little bit like this. So if you call this a flinch reflex, then it's in the first move of hand, it's in the second move, it's in the third move, right here. Then the next move here, we're back to threw a punch out like this as well. That's fine. So it shows up a lot, and I think it was meant to teach you self-defense. So that's why I think it's one of the most important ones. He took his best, most secret, most effective stuff and said, this is what we're going to do. And some people misunderstand it, so I put it out there, and somebody said, oh, no, that's not what I was taught. That's one of the biggest things. But another one is, well, no, it should look more like Krav Maga. Yeah, Krav Maga is an Israeli self-defense system that was created by a guy that teaches soldiers right now so they can do self-defense. And one of his rules is to block and hit at the same time. Which, if he throws a punch, what is that? That's a block and hit at the same time. That's what that is. It is Krav Maga. So, if any of these blocks are the same thing, blocking and hit at the same time, if you can, that's what it is. So, he's that. So, and there's 2 different ways to do that. One is he threw the punch and I stop him. That's great. Shows up here, shows up here. He's done a lot of things. Shows up here, you know. One is I cover it and then I gotta move forward and hit him.
Attention local patrons, the time is now 7:30 and the facility is closing in 30 minutes. Locker room is made available 15 minutes following closing. Please wait the time accordingly. Thank you.
He said
8:30 and then in 30 minutes.
So at 1:45 we're going to stop so that we can put our stuff away, go change, have a couple shower. So this, at first glance, is a form of Zen type stuff. You block, and then you hit. Unless you strike on the way up and on the way out. So this is a strike, that's a strike, that's a strike. There's more in there for your old. From here, this something like that that looks totally ridiculous becomes super effective to to mess that up for us. So we often think that karate is very rigid, very simplistic thing. And it is in the sport part. It is in the competition part. Because that's the only part they want to use. And the other parts are more dangerous. They break limbs and arms and necks and eyes. There. See what happened when you asked a question? Andy died. Out. Down.
Andy done.
One. One. Two, three. One. Two, three. One, two, three. I know, see, just having that stick there makes it messes you up. One, two, three. One, two, one, two. This is a harder one. One. There you go. Two, three. One. I don't know the word, but also here. Boom. Two, three. One. Yep. That was the cover. Yep. Arms in close. This one out. The trigger body sideways a lot. No, the other side is. So you wedge in here, it's a little bigger. Elbow. Yep. One. That's a dollar rock. One cent. Two. One. Heel. So you are working on your stances, which is great. It was a problem before. But one thing you can work on is to make your back foot more stable. So it has to move a little like that. But yours, it moves a lot. It moves every time you leave it there, drive, power, leave it there, push it. So sometimes this is very subtle. You are turning your head when you punch. That's fantastic. But sometimes you're not hitting with your center, you're turning your head. And sometimes you do hit with your center, and now with your left, you're working quick. This kind of dead, even if it's flat. So if you do a block of any kind, yep, and then you punch, you go one. So it's not bad. But push it as your leg hurts. Oh, there you go. You do that. Push. That hits the target. Your legs and your body. It runs out. Got it. Feet together. Out. Hey, I'll be back.
Hey, yep.
Yeah.
One. One. Two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two. One, two. One, two, three. One. Two, three. One. No, four. Don't punch out. One. Nope. This is going to wind up by your ear. Nope. This hand is going to go up by this ear. Up, but not my knee. Go back. You're going to move the stick with it. Yep, as you move forward. One, boom, that's the trick. Go ahead. Good job. One, yeah. You see why?
Yes.
One, two. Thank you.
Hey!
Pass it out. Follow along my finger. Out. And out.
Right.
One. Two. Three. Four. Five. Six. Seven. Eight. So in this pod, there are several wavelets right at the beginning, right here. One, two, here. One, two, here. One, two. They're like everywhere. Some cells took all of those out. And I looked at the oldest pod I could find on video or in books. Some of them have it in there, some of them don't. And I totally think it depends on what you think you're doing with it. I think they're important and I want you to leave them in there. You're hitting somebody with it. Bang! Before you go. If you think this is a block, then this is a waste of time. So I get why they get rid of it. Because if you don't know what it's for, and he says block, this isn't helping you. You got hope for God. You gotta get out there. But so far, in other places, we look for like for no reason, and I find other styles that don't. So all karate systems that are modern tend to make things the same. Oh, well, we do this here, it must be that over here. Maybe it was, maybe it wasn't, but now it is, it's all the same. I'm trying to change some things back. So I originally learned in Matsudai Gongdai and in Tekken, you go one, two. Some people decided long ago in their day, this is a block. So they go one, two, and they step one over there. Even though this is terrible, it stands for a block. You might just sit on the way. So that's not a good application. But then if one step further, this is wall or other blocks quite underneath. So it must be one, two. And it just gets further and further away from something useful. So I would prefer to go one, two, one, two. Some people again go one, two of these leap bearing twists. There's only one or two applications for that, and they don't require the big body. So I think this is the leap to the up straight. This is the body. Boom! Drop the body weight on the back straight. Basarai. Out. Out. Good. Close. The other toes. One. Left shoulder. Keep your legs. Two. Three. Both of one. Middle.
the facilities will be closing in 15 minutes. All activity areas will be closing in 15 minutes. Locker rooms will be available for 15 minutes following closing. Please plan your time accordingly. Thank you.
Zoom class that nobody came to.